Well, good morning and welcome. It's hard to believe that next Sunday is the first day of spring, winter's last gasp. But we're glad you're here with us, and certainly if you are a guest, we welcome you and glad you come to be with us. And also want to welcome those who are joining us by way of our live stream, and thank you for being a part of our worship, and hope you are safe and warm where you are. Let us pray as we begin. Our fathers, we gather as a family this morning and for this time of worship in the name of Christ. We thank you for your presence with us and pray that you will bless all of us present and be with those who are absent from us for whatever cause. And we pray that what we do this morning will bring glory and honor to you. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen.
Morning. Well, it's only been 2 years since I led singing, so thank you. And I wasn't expecting to this week necessarily. I did offer to Robbie if there was an issue that I would step in, and of course Robin had foot construction surgery, total foot construction surgery this week, and he texted me last night about 7:30 or so and said, hey, it's not too late. And so at the same time, he sent me an email with the order of worship. So I think it was a done deal at that point. So. But I'll be up and down. I told Mark I'd have to use this lapel mic. I can't hold the microphone. But and then I'm going to fill in for Mark preaching next week. So you'll get your fill of me this next 2 weeks.
Jesus, let us come to know you. Let us see you face to face. Touch us, hold us, use us, mold us. Only the river of your
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time we have to come together as a family to sing songs of praise and to study your word and to help us to improve our Christian lives. We ask you this week to be with those that are traveling during the spring break. Help everyone to make it to their destination and home safely. We ask you at this time to be with the situation in Europe with Ukraine and Russia and all the countries involved in this situation. We ask you to bring this to a quick end, if that's your will. We ask you to be with those of our number that are missing this morning due to illness or to other obligations, and ask you to bring them back to their place among us. We thank you so much for everything you do, and mainly that you sent your son because you love us so much. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Please stand with me if you're able. I understand that more now. I can't stand all the time. So. After this song, we'll be seated, have our scripture reading, and Mark will bring our message.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul, my sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin not in part, but the whole is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when the face shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul.
Please be seated.
Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Ephesians chapter 6, verses 18 through 20. With every prayer and request, pray at all times in the Spirit, and with this in view, be alert with all perseverance and every request for all the saints. And pray in my behalf that speech may be given to me in the opening of my mouth to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel for which I am an ambassador in chains. In proclaiming it, I may speak boldly as I ought to speak.
Amen. Thank you so much, Keith. If you got your Bible with you this morning, whether you are here in our building in person or whether you are worshiping on our live stream, I would encourage you to hold it up and keep it up. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Join me this morning in our text that Keith just read for us in Ephesians chapter 6. Whether you are here in person or whether you're on our live stream, we are grateful for the presence of each one of you today. If you are here in person and you are our guest today, on the back of the pew in front of you, you will find a yellow card that says guest on it. If you would fill that out and leave that on the pew where you are, we would appreciate that very much. If you're joining us on our live stream, and I have a feeling with the weather being what it is and traveling being what it is in some places, we may have a few more folks on our live stream today. We're grateful for each of you. If you don't mind, let us know that you're with us, that you're worshiping with us, and if you're from outside of our area, we would love to know where you are worshiping from today. Wasn't it good to see Tim back up here? That'd be a good time for an amen. Amen. So good to see you back up here, brother. We love and appreciate you and glad you're able to do what you're doing this morning. We are in a series that I am calling It's a War Out There. We're talking about spiritual warfare. We're talking about this invisible spiritual battle that rages all around us. But the irony is, a lot of us as Christians act like this battle isn't even happening. We sort of think it's science fiction or it's fantasy or something like that. But nobody is immune from the consequences of spiritual warfare. I'm going to say that again. Nobody is immune from the consequences of spiritual warfare. The enemy comes after you, he comes after your family, he comes after everything that you hold dear. And so this morning as we come to Ephesians 6, 18 to 20, I want to talk to you about prayer and spiritual warfare. Last week we looked at the verses right before this and we talked about the armor of God. We talked about what God has given us in order to fight this battle. This week we're going to talk not just about what God has given us, or we're going to talk about how we are to fight and why we are to fight this battle. So I'm going to encourage you, if you would, to bow with me as we prepare to get into our lesson this morning. Let's bow together. Father, thank you for our time this morning. Thank you for keeping us safe and bringing us to this place. Father, as we come here, as human beings, we come with many cares and concerns. And God, we know we can't completely put those things out of our mind because they're on our heart. But God, I ask you in the midst of those things today that you would help us to focus our heart and focus our mind on what you want to say to us through your word this morning. Father, I pray you would help me to speak it with accuracy and with clarity. We pray it today in Jesus' name. Amen. When you look at the last part of the book of Ephesians, prayer really is the theme of this section. And even though Paul doesn't mention it as a specific part of the armor of God that we looked at last time, don't think that it's disconnected from the armor. It isn't. It's not just another piece of the godly armor that we have, but prayer really is the context in which all of this armor is to be put on. Prayer, I read one person said this week and I thought it was good. Prayer is the air that we breathe as soldiers of Jesus. It's the all-pervasive strategy of how we are to go about waging this war. And so that makes it very, very important. When you're reading through this text, I think it's important to remember that in the original language that the New Testament was written in, there really aren't any punctuation marks. Can you imagine trying to figure all that out? That's fun when you're doing Greek, isn't it, Tim? There really aren't any punctuation marks, nor are there chapter and verse divisions. And so when you're reading through Ephesians 6, and you read verse 17, and then you read into verse 18, there really isn't a break there. They are connected. And so again, prayer is directly connected with the armor that we are to wear. It's in the context of prayer that we put on the breastplate of righteousness. It's in the context of prayer that we fasten on the belt of truth. You get the idea. Everything that we do, spiritually speaking, in this invisible war has to be saturated in prayer. And again, that makes prayer pretty important. So let's talk about prayer and its place in spiritual warfare this morning as we dive into Ephesians 6. Here's the first thing I want you to notice in verses 18 through 20. I want you to notice Paul talks about how we should pray. Paul talks about how we should pray. Prayer is the energy that we need in order to fight this battle. We cannot do it in our own power. I've said this before in this series. It does not matter how strong you are. It does not matter how talented you think you are. We are desperate for the power and the presence of God. I really do think that the missing ingredient in many of our lives as Christians, the missing ingredient in many churches, is the ingredient of prayer. I mean, strong, biblical, faithful, comprehensive, Christ-centered, Spirit-filled prayer. It's missing in so many of our lives. It's missing in so many of our churches. And when it is, we miss out sometimes on what God has for us because we're not really committed to prayer. Notice again what Paul says in verse 18. He says, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. There's a lot in that verse. And so let's just kind of unpack it a little bit without getting too bogged down in it. But I think we need to see some things here. Notice, first of all, what Paul says about warfare prayer. He says that it's prayer that needs to be consistent. It needs to be consistent prayer. He says, praying at all times. When it comes to spiritual warfare, everything that we do needs to be covered in prayer. As a follower of Jesus Christ, everything you do, every choice you make, every place you go, every word you say ought to be filtered through the Spirit of God and covered in prayer. That's why Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 5:17, my favorite memory verses when I was in Sunday school, pray without ceasing. That one I can get. Pray without ceasing. So what does that mean? Does that mean, and we've talked about this verse before, does that mean that I'm always to be walking around with my hands in a prayer posture and my head bowed, bumping into things? That's not what he's talking about. Not what he means. When Paul talks about praying at all times and praying without ceasing, it means you and I ought to be in such consistent and constant communion with God that whenever anything happens throughout our day, whether it's good or bad, my very first inclination is to talk to my Father about it. There's this connection between God and me that it doesn't need to be severed, right? There's that connection there. There's always this connection between God and me. Consistent prayer. Pray without ceasing. Pray at all times. But then Paul talks about what we might call comprehensive prayer. He says, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. In other words, we ought to pray comprehensively. Now, I'm going to put the entirety of verse 18 back on the screen for you. And I want us to, I was hoping I had actually put that slide in there because I intended to. I want us to read it again, and I'm going to emphasize one particular word as it occurs over and over and over again in this one verse. And I think Paul's trying to tell us something. He says, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. Do you think Paul might be trying to communicate something to us here as he just uses this word over and over and over again? Our prayers ought to be comprehensive in their nature. In other words, we don't need to just get on our knees and pray, oh God, help me have a good day today. God, please forgive me of my sin. Bless everybody I know. Amen. And then just go. That's not what the Bible has in mind when it talks about this kind of prayer. We need to pray specifically. We need to pray consistently. We need to pray comprehensively. One of the ways we do that, Paul mentions in verse 18, is supplication. That word just means to make your requests to God. We're pretty good at that one, right? We got that one down pretty good. We make our requests to God. But listen, that's not the only way that the Bible talks about prayer. The Bible also talks about intercession, where you're praying for someone else. The Bible also talks about praise and thanksgiving. There are multiple ways that you pray. And listen, if you only pray for the stuff that you want, there's so much more that God wants to do in your life through prayer. We ought to also pray with intercession, lifting up our family, lifting up our friends that need to know Jesus, praying for missionaries around the world. We ought to pray with praise and thanksgiving, just adoring God and worshiping God and thanking God for all the ways He's blessed us. And so there's consistent prayer. Pray at all times. There's comprehensive prayer with all these alls that we see in the passage. And then next, I'm going to call it careful prayer. And I'll explain what I mean by that. Careful prayer. Paul says, pray with care and caution. Pray by keeping alert with all thanksgiving. In other words, remember, we are in a spiritual battle. And we've got to pray with that recognition, right? One author says that prayer is sort of like the walkie-talkie, and I debated whether to use that. Because everybody in here know what a walkie-talkie is? Some of the younger people might go, what in the world is a walkie? You know the little handheld radios that you can communicate with by speaking into it, and somebody else has one and they can hear too. Y'all all know what I'm talking about. This person said prayer is like the walkie-talkie that we have that enables us to communicate constantly in this battle with our commanding general. We're alert. There's a battle that's going on around us. We connect with God consistently and faithfully through prayer. See, our enemy, we've seen this in this series, our enemy will try to trick us and deceive us and catch us off guard. He will do everything he can to kill, steal, and destroy. And so we've got to live and we've got to pray with caution and care. Something I read this week, one person suggested that we really need to pray with our eyes open. And I thought that was an interesting way to put it. What do you mean, pray with your eyes open? How often does the Bible talk about watch and pray and connect those two things? Watch and pray. Jesus did. Matthew 26:41. Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. So prayer isn't just about me being on my knees, on my face, with my eyes closed before God. It's also about walking forward in faith, being alert, being watchful, being vigilant, right? So I can fight this battle that is in front of me. Watching and praying really is one of the secrets to winning the spiritual war. Consistent prayer, comprehensive prayer, careful prayer. I'm going to call this last one connected prayer. This one is crucial. Look at what he says at the very end of verse 18. He says, we're making supplication for all the saints. You see, when it comes to spiritual warfare, there is a very important principle every one of us needs to understand. You are not in this battle by yourself. You are not intended to fight this battle all on your own. We're in this with all the saints. The Holy Spirit dwells in me. The Holy Spirit dwells in you. We have this connection in the family of God. We're connected to other Christ followers. As the body of Christ move forward, we move forward together praying for one another, right? We're connected. And we fight for the victory together. Do you remember how Jesus taught us to pray in the Sermon on the Mount? Sometimes we call it the Lord's Prayer, the model prayer. Jesus taught us to pray. Do you know how he started? Remember? Our Father. The interesting thing about that model prayer, when you go down through it, Jesus doesn't use singular pronouns as if he's just one person talking to God. He always uses not me, mine, mine, but we and our and us. What's Jesus trying to teach us? I think one thing he's teaching us is that the discipled life, the Christ-centered life, is lived out in the context of community. where we're connected with one another as Christians as we fight our battles. We do that together, making supplication for all the saints. Let me ask you this. Think about it. Who are the most influential people right now in our world? Who are the most influential people in the world? You might answer that by, we typically think of presidents, generals, military leaders. Maybe some people think of movie stars or musicians or maybe businessmen or businesswomen that are movers and shakers and are making stuff happen here in our country or throughout the world. I want you to listen to what a guy named S.D. Gordon wrote, because I think he says this very, very well. And it's convicting. The greatest people of earth, he says, today, are the people who pray. Listen to what he says. I do not mean the people who talk about prayer, nor those who say they believe in prayer, nor those who can explain about prayer. I mean those who take the time and pray. They have not time. It must be taken from something else. That something else is important, very important and pressing, but still less important and less pressing than prayer. Phew. That'll get you. I ran across something years ago that I have shared here before, but it's been a little while, and I don't remember exactly when I shared it last. Amy could probably tell me. I'm not sure. But I'm going to share it again this morning. We probably have some new people since the last time I shared it. Maybe one of the struggles that you have with praying is just how to go about doing it. We really make it more complicated than it ought to be sometimes, and we get a little bit intimidated, and we don't really know how to pray. I ran across this little acrostic years ago that has been helpful to me in learning how to pray when I'm struggling with prayer. It's just the word ACTS, like the book of the Bible, ACTS, A-C-T-S. Every one of those letters stands for a part of the prayer. I'm just going to walk you through it if you've never heard that before. If you have, maybe it'll be good to hear it again, right? A is just for adoration. You begin your prayer by just giving God praise and worship for who He is. That's what Jesus did. That's what He taught us to do in the model prayer. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed, holy, holy is your name. That's worship. That's adoration. C stands for confession. If you're like me, you got some stuff. You got some stuff in your life that you need to get out there. You got some stuff that you in your life that you need to get right. And you need to make sure as you pray, you're confessing that before God. And you're expressing to Him your sorrow, not just for breaking His law, but for breaking His heart. And that's what our sin does. T is for thanksgiving. Thanksgiving. Just express gratitude for all of this. Very specific. Be specific. Don't just say, Lord, thank you for blessing me. Be specific about the things that you know God has blessed you with. And you and I both know He's blessed us far more than we ever deserve or could ever imagine. He's blessed us in incredible ways. Thanksgiving, that's an important part of prayer. And then finally, S, this is where we're pretty good. We don't need a lot of help with the S, but the A and the C and the T sometimes is a struggle. S is just for supplication. Make your requests known to God. Ask God for what you need. Don't be afraid to do that. Jesus does in the model prayer, God give us this day our daily bread, right? He's talking about specific physical needs, spiritual needs, emotional needs, relational needs. Be specific about those things. There it is, A-C-T-S, adoration, confession, thanksgiving, prayer, supplication. All those things can work together in prayer. And so if you're confused and you just, Mark, I don't know where to start, just start there. It's going to feel a little weird when you start thinking through the A and the C and the T and the S and walking through it one by one, but just do it. You'll be amazed at what you learn about how to adore God and how to confess your sin before Him and how to express your gratitude to Him and how to lift up your supplications before Him. So Paul talks about how we should pray. But there's something else I want you to see in the text this morning. Not only the how, but I want you to see the why. Why should we pray? I think we get this in verses 19 and 20 of Ephesians 6. And what Paul tells us here is prayer is not preparation for the battle. Prayer is the battle. Y'all catch that? Prayer is not preparation for the work. Prayer is the work. It is in prayer, it is in this one-on-one dialogue with God that we find the strength we need in order to face the enemy. One person put it this way, referring to the devil, referring to our enemy. This is also very convicting. Speaking of the devil, he says, he fears nothing from prayerless studies, prayerless work, and prayerless religion. He laughs at our toil and he mocks our wisdom. But he trembles when we pray. He laughs at all the other stuff we do that's totally disconnected from prayer and dependence on him. But he trembles when we pray. In other words, it is only when we pray that we put Satan back on his heels a little bit. As Paul concludes this passage, he makes a personal appeal, and I want you to see it. He's taught us how to pray. Now he says this in verses 19 and 20. He says, and I want you to also pray for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. He makes a personal appeal for these Christians in Ephesus. He says, please, would you pray for me? By the way, if Paul needed people to pray for him, you probably do too. If Paul needed people to pray for him, you probably do too. But notice, this is the convicting part to me, notice what he asks them to pray for. I love it and am convicted by it all at the same time. He doesn't say, because remember where he's at, he's in prison with his bleeding ankles stuck in some stocks and doesn't know what tomorrow necessarily is going to bring. He does not pray, would y'all please pray for my ankles, that my ankles would heal and that they would get better as I'm here in these stocks. Please pray that they heal. That would have been fine to pray for. That's not what he mentions. He doesn't pray, would you pray that I might be set free from prison? He doesn't pray that. He doesn't pray, hey, would y'all please pray for me that I might maintain my health in this prison? He doesn't pray that. What does he pray? Folks, here is the ultimate why of prayer. He says, pray that I might boldly proclaim the mystery of the gospel. What is the goal of spiritual warfare? What is the goal of prayer as Christ followers? Ultimately, it is that the gospel would go forth and the light would expel the darkness and the kingdom of God would advance and people would come to know Jesus. That's the goal in all of this. And that's Paul's desire too. Why should we pray? Why should we pray? Ultimately, because through prayer, the gospel of Jesus advances throughout the world. We're all heartbroken at the images we see coming out of Ukraine and the suffering that many of those people are enduring. I want you to know this past week I saw on my Facebook feed, and I didn't stop to read every detail of everything that I saw, but I saw post after post of people, men and women, in the waters of baptism who just now are committing their life to Jesus and are following Him in the midst of all this conflict. Do we need to pray that the conflict would end? Certainly. Do we need to pray that there would be peace? Certainly. But we also need to pray that in the midst of the conflict, the good news of Jesus would go forth. Because it is. This is the goal. This is what Paul says it is all about. I'm going to tell you this as we wrap up this morning, and then the lesson's yours. God has arranged it this way, and I don't claim to understand it. I don't think you understand it either. I don't think there's a theologian around that, Tim, that really understands it, though they might say they do. But I'm going to tell you, there are some things that God will do whether we pray or not. He just chooses to do those things. But there are other things where God has arranged it that He will not do it unless and until we pray. I don't understand it. I can't graph it for you. Can't put it on a chart. Can't do any of that. But the reality is there are some things God will not do unless and until we are obedient to Him in prayer. So, let's be praying people. Let's pray as individuals. Let's pray in our families. We all have room for improvement there, including me. Let's pray as a church. Let's be committed to prayer so that God can work and move to the fullest extent and that the gospel can go forth. Join me in prayer as we conclude. Father, whenever we talk about prayer, we are both encouraged and convicted, I think, at the same time. We're encouraged when we think of the power that is there at our disposal in talking to the Creator and Sustainer of the universe. But God, we're also very convicted that we don't do it nearly as often as we should. We don't rely on You nearly as much as we should. And maybe in the midst of our requests and our prayers that we make, we often become focused on things, though they're important. We maybe don't talk about to You the things that are most important. Father, help us to be a people that are committed to prayer. Help us to rely on You. Help us to depend on You. And God, we do pray that through our prayers, the gospel would move forth. God, we pray for missionaries right now in the midst of Ukraine who are telling people about Your Son. God, give them safety. Help them to proclaim boldly the message of Your Son. But not just in Ukraine, Father, in Athens. Help us to do that as well. It's our prayer today in Jesus' name. Amen. If we can help you today to know Jesus, to have a relationship with Him. Maybe you don't have that. If you're here, one of our shepherds is going to be down front in just a moment. You can come, tell him I want to know more about Jesus. If you're on our live stream today and you need to know more about the Lord Jesus Christ, message me. I want to help you any way that I can to know Him and to follow Him. Whatever your spiritual need, right now, you come. Let us know so we can pray to the Father about that while we stand and while we sing.
Wash away my sin, nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. But the blood of Jesus.
Romans chapter 4, verses 7 through 8, Paul quotes a psalm of David when he says, "Blessed are those whose lawless deeds have been forgiven and whose sins have been covered. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord will not take into account." When God covers our sins, he doesn't just turn his head and pretend he doesn't see, or he doesn't just mark it up to our human weaknesses. Our sins had to be dealt with. As we enter into this communion together, we remember how and why our sins have been covered. It's because God sent his Son, his beloved Son, to come and cover our sins with his own blood, so that now when God looks down on us, he doesn't see us in our lawless state, but he sees the righteousness of his Son. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, in our human understanding, we realize just how blessed we are because you have covered our sins with the blood of your Son. So we now share in this bread the emblem of his body that was nailed and pierced with the spear so that our sins could be covered and we could be restored to you. So in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray, amen. Father, as we continue in this communion, we also ask you to bless this cup, the cup that symbolizes the blood that poured out of Jesus' body so that our sins could be forgiven. As we drink from this cup now, we remember his sacrifice and the hope that we have in him. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
we want to mention, there we go, that's always better, just a few things we want to mention as far as our family matters are concerned before we dismiss this morning. Remember the Rooted groups, at least some of them are meeting tonight. I think some of them are probably not meeting due to a lot of folks traveling. If you're in a Rooted group and have any question about whether your group is meeting or not, please check with your Rooted group leader. I'm sure by now you know that, but just in case, do make note of that. Amy and I are going to be leaving tomorrow for a week, and so our Wednesday morning 10 o'clock class will not be meeting this week. So if you're in that class, do make note of that. Our Wednesday morning class, March 16th, will not be meeting. There are a couple of events coming up the next two Saturdays that you need to be aware of. The men's prayer breakfast is March 19th, and the elders' appreciation dinner is March the 26th. There are more details about that in either both of those events in the bulletin. There are sign-up sheets. This is the most important thing about those. There are sign-up sheets for both of them on the bulletin board. Please check those out and sign up today if you can. We are in the process of collecting the feedback forms for Billy Murfin. If you did not get a form, they are still located on the guest desk. We're asking you to get those back in no later than next Sunday, March 20th. So if you're planning on filling out a form, please get those to Becca or to myself as soon as you can. There are several new thank you cards that have been posted on the bulletin board down here by the restrooms. Please check those out before you leave today. Also, you may have noticed, if you checked your mailbox, you may have noticed two things. The directory, the new directory, the updated pages are in your mailbox, and you may also have noticed your mailbox is not where it was last Sunday. It's moved a little bit as we have adjusted them, so do make note of that and do check your box and get your directory before you leave today. A huge thank you needs to go to Becca Pitney for all the work she put into this directory, and Brenda was a big help to Becca as well, so we thank both of these ladies for the hard work. Y'all have no idea the hard work that they put into getting these together. So do check those and pick those up as you leave today. We are in the process of updating our transportation ministry policy. The goal is we want to make sure that both of our vehicles are always ready to go anytime they are needed. And so part of this update to the policy is going to be we're going to check out the vehicles through the office. That's kind of how that's going to work. And so what that means is if you have a key to either of the vehicles, please turn those in to Becca as soon as you can, and the process will be now to check those out through Becca in the future. If you have any questions about that, Joe Pitney will be glad to answer them for you and to help you with anything regarding that. If you are a part of our church family and you're here this morning and you haven't had a chance yet to give your contribution, there is a box on the table for that. There also is a trash can to your right as you exit the main doors where you can put your empty communion cups this morning. We're going to be sending out the prayer list later today. Two things that come to my mind, though, that we really need to be praying about. Mike Massengale is having his heart surgery tomorrow. He has gone through quite an ordeal to get this done, and it looks like it's going to happen this time, so please be in prayer about that. Also, Carolyn Herod is having a PET scan tomorrow and to determine really the extent of her cancer, so we certainly need to be praying about that, and many others as well. Join me in prayer, and we will be dismissed this morning. Father, thank you for the blessing and the honor and the privilege of worshiping you today, whether here in this room or whether on this live stream. I thank you for each of my brothers and sisters that are a part of this church family. I pray, God, that as we leave this place today, that we would leave with a recognition of the spiritual battle that's going on around us, and that we would leave determined to be people of prayer and dependence and reliance on you. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Y'all have a blessed week.